Well, welcome back to North Star Oasis. I'm your host, Jeff Williams. I want to apologize to our regular viewers out there who expected to see a regular program last week and not a rerun. Yes, it was the 4th of July, so if you were tuning in, you would have seen the episode that we had put together the week before. There was a little bit of scheduling mix-up and conflict that we had here in studio, and so we pretty much figured that we'll have to just throw in the previous week. So we are here today, July 11th. We are live on Suburban Community Channels. We're here on St. Paul News Network, SPNN. And we're right in the middle of summer, and we're really thankful for having you. Just a reminder, we are on Facebook, we are on Twitter, we are on YouTube. And our extension is North Star Oasis. So you can tune in, watch our rebroadcast of our shows. You can also take part in our discussion and, of course, give us feedback on all three of those forums. So please go to our Facebook page and like North Star Oasis. Well, before we begin today's episode, we're going to really start off with a tribute. If you're of my generation, growing up in the 70s and 80s, then in the world of the NFL, the name Ken Stabler, should come to mind as one of the best quarterbacks of that era. And yes, to you Vikings fans out there, Ken Stabler is also probably not so well remembered for the 1977 Super Bowl, but Ken Stabler passed away this past week at the age of 69 after a 5 to 6 month bout with colon cancer. And so we're going to play just a short little tribute video to remember Ken the Snake Stabler. And if we can go back on that video real quick, right to the very, very end, it kind of faded real quick. Right there, yes, that is yours truly with Kenny Stabler. He and I were at the NFL Legends Golf Tournament together back in 2010. And I have to tell you this, that I can't remember the name of the rule, but he had, in one of the games, he had done a fumble, and the Raiders ended up getting a touchdown, and there was a rule that was changed because of that. And for many, many years, Stabler had insisted, no, he didn't throw it. It was a legitimate fumble. But there at the NFL Legends, he was telling us, yeah, well, I just kind of threw it up there just to see what the guys would do. And, we didn't have instant replay back then. But, hey, we were just trying to do whatever it took to win. And I had to make a split decision. And I just kind of flipped it up. And we figured, well, let's see what happens with it. And the play just resulted in a touchdown. Well, the play also resulted in a rule change. But the one thing is, Kenny Stabler, he put it out there every single game. He kind of the Brett Favre of our era was Kenny Stabler back in his era. And I'll tell you, as somebody who's been a diehard long-time football fan, and who had the good graces of meeting him and cutting up with him for one night. Kenny Stabler will be missed by anybody associated with the NFL. Well, that being said, we are now 79 weeks and 5 days away from the next presidential inauguration. Now, we've been going through on a regular weekly basis the presidential flavor of the week. You know, we start off with Ted Cruz, and we had Rand Paul, Hillary Clinton, Marco Rubio, Bernie Sanders, Ben Carson, Carly Fiorina, Mike Huckabee, Rick Santorum, George Pataki, pretty much in the order in which they had announced. And you can go and see all of our previous episodes on our Facebook or our YouTube channel. And today's presidential flavor of the week is Martin O'Malley.
Together we made our city a safer, healthier, and better place for kids. Together we made our city believe again, and we invented a better and new way of governing called CityStat, and we got things done. Together we made our state's public schools the best in the nation. We made college more affordable for more families. When you see a dad sweating through another long shift in order to give his daughter a better future, I want you to be able to tell that dad, I voted for you. When you see a mom working long hours at two jobs for the dream of being able to send her only son to college, I want you to be able to tell her, I voted for you. And when you see a young father who hungers for a decent job to support his family, I want you to be able to tell him, I voted for you. For the story of our country's best days is not found in a history book, because this generation of Americans is about to write it. And that is why today, to you and to all who can hear my voice, I declare that I am a candidate for President of the United States, and I am running for you. May God bless you, and may God bless the United States of America. Thank you.
Well, Martin O'Malley is going to need a lot of Democrats voting for him if he's going to get the presidential nomination from his party. Simply because, according to the Real Clear Politics Averager polls, and this is effective date of June 28th, so it's a couple of weeks out of whack here, but Hillary Clinton, 62.8% average. Bernie Sanders, 14.3%. Vice President Joe Biden, 13.3%. Jim Webb, the former Virginia senator, 2.3%. Martin O'Malley, 1.3%. So he's commanding, as of the 28th of June, 1.3% of Democrat support. So he's going to have a lot of Democrats voting for him. So let's take a look at Martin O'Malley's campaign ad.
We'd like to make an announcement. We will not stick our finger in the air to see which way the wind is blowing. We will take stands, important ones.
I believe that we are standing at the threshold of a new era of American opportunity. If only we have the guts and have the foresight and have the courage.
We will not talk about doing big things. We will do them.
In Maryland, we passed a living wage.
We passed marriage equality, and we passed the DREAM Act.
We made our public schools the best in America 5 years in a row.
We will allow ourselves to feel, but steel ourselves to act.
The week that Baltimore erupted was a heartbreaking week for all of us. In so many places in our country, there are whole swaths of our population that feel unneeded, unrecognized, unnecessary, and unheard. We must do better as a people.
We will never forget where we come from, but always remember where we're going.
My dad was able to go to college only because of the GI Bill. He was from a fairly poor family in Pittsburgh, and only because of a far-seeing and generous nation, he was able to go to college. He was able to provide better for his family. And that's really what our country's all about at our best, is to recognize the potential in each individual to make us better as a whole nation.
This is America. We don't coronate or hand out turns. We earn it.
Well, that was Martin O'Malley's campaign video. I noticed that he tried putting the smackdown on both Hillary Clinton and Jeb Bush. I just don't know how many people are actually going to see that. I think former Maryland Governor O'Malley has a lot of work that he's got to do. But just kind of like when we had profiled Marco Rubio, there were protesters outside of Martin O'Malley's speech. And let's take a look. And this one, Dallas, is on my computer.
Just gathered to say his management of the city helped widen the racial and economic divide that was front and center in a worldwide debate about the ills of Baltimore in the wake of the death of Freddie Gray in police custody last month.
You did nothing for Baltimore! You did not help us! You left us in a rain! Look at us now!
You know, black lives don't matter when we're getting brutally murdered, but we can't even come to an event and say a public space to say that black lives matter?
Federal Hill is a predominantly affluent and white neighborhood, the type of area that thrived under O'Malley's watch. But in the West Baltimore neighborhood where Gray died, residents say O'Malley failed to deliver and even made things worse. Part of the problem was his aggressive police strategy called zero tolerance that intensified aggressive policing and led to tens of thousands of illegal arrests without addressing the underlying causes of crime and poverty.
I want people to start really accepting the fact that there is structural racism, white supremacy at work in our systems, I'm not done, and that zero tolerance policies do not work. Punishment does not work.
While the homicide rate dropped initially after zero tolerance, murders began to climb by the middle of the decade and did not drop again until the policy was abandoned by his predecessor, Sheila Dixon. Meanwhile, the strategy was the subject of a successful lawsuit by the NAACP and ACLU. Such policy, residents say, is at the root of a culture of confrontational policing that lead to encounters with police like the one which killed Gray. It's a legacy that O'Malley says that he will embrace, but also comes at a time when tough policing in black communities is not only under fire from residents, it's coming under increasing national scrutiny. In fact, the Baltimore Police Department is currently the subject of three separate federal investigations. Sergeant Lewis Hobson, the lead plaintiff in a landmark civil rights lawsuit against the city, says O'Malley was initially an advocate for black officers.
Now Martin stood up and he had hearings for us. I didn't expect anything more, you know. And he said one time, Hoptus wasn't my fight. He said the civil rights discrimination issue, that's really not my fight.
But O'Malley later distanced himself from the struggle to rid the beleaguered department of racism.
And it's not what you do out in public and the words that you say. It's what you do after you've been told, or after you see the truth. So Martin has to go back and look at the books, like the Red Books, the investigation in which he himself conducted. And he has to ask himself and he has to explain to the public, well, once I knew about this, what did I do?
And the final. Still, the Democrat hovering around 1% in the polls appeared optimistic.
It is the threat of generosity, compassion, and love that brings us together as one American people.
With Stephen Janis, this is Jessel North in Baltimore.
Well, that is our highlight on Martin O'Malley. Now, let me take a quick look here, and it looks like next week we will be highlighting Lindsey Graham. So if you happen to like South Carolina, I think next week is a show for you. But right now, we actually have a special guest here today. It's a guy, a person that I've known. He's a dear friend of mine. I've known him now for 5 years. And you know my passion for history. If you've been a regular viewer and heard this presentation on the First Corps at Gettysburg back in the fall of 2010, and it was from a person who had just finished his tenure as a licensed battlefield guide at Gettysburg. And so with us today is John D. Cox, who is an author of a few books and one of the most well-versed people that I know on Gettysburg. John, welcome to the show.
Thanks, Jeff. Thanks for having me on. I appreciate it.
So first, let's see your book, Gettysburg.
The famous Gettysburg book. Here's the Gettysburg book.
Gettysburg, A History for the People.
Right. Really, the only book you ever want to own for Gettysburg. And I wrote it for the person that knows a great deal about Gettysburg and for the person that doesn't know anything. And I wrote it so that, the people that fought at Gettysburg were people. They mm-hmm. were real people, with real struggles and families and things like we are today. I mean, I didn't want to make them so distant. And I tried to, write this for the soldiers and the civilians that survived.
So this is not a look through the eyes of all the generals, but nobody else matters type book.
Correct. Absolutely. I wrote it. I've had some great comments about it. One guy said it should be, a history. It really is a history of the people.
Cool.
And that's the way, I wanted the reader to get in touch with, the average soldier that fought in this tremendous battle.
Well, right now we're going to show a brief clip of you giving a tour to the Minnesota Civil War Commemoration Task Force, on which I serve, and the group that we had 2 years ago who were out at Gettysburg. And it's just a small snip. It's just to give you a flavor of John's humor.
Everybody got walking shoes on. They say there is nowhere to park anywhere near the Minnesota Monument. Plus, two of my guide colleagues just took two buses from Minnesota, and they said they had to just drive by. They said there's around 15,000 people on Little Round Top at any one time. We won't even get near it, or we might get views of it from a distance. I'm kind of afraid to attempt it to get boxed in, but we're going to have a great time anyways. So none of these problems. So you know what? We're gonna do whatever we can do, right? So yeah, maybe. Anyways, we're from Minnesota. We'll kick them out. We charged them off the field once. We can do it again. All right. So anyways, so now you got that information. So we're off and we're going about. I promise you, at some point, that I'm going to do the tour in chronological order. First day, second day, third day, but I'm not going to do that yet. So I think we're going to start maybe with the third day first, right? And we're going to take it over to Culp's Hill, and we're going to maybe spend an hour there. I wrote a book on it, and I love it over there, and maybe it won't be so crowded, and we'll have a good time. All right. This was filled with trees, and the Park Service done a really good job clearing this. Looks a lot more like it did in 1863. The battlefield today has a lot more trees on it than it did in 1863. And the Park Service, and I'll be the first one to back them, if they do something wrong, has done a tremendous job trying to clear trees and brushes and whatever to make the battlefield look more and more like it did in 1863. And so the place where they've done some of their best work is here on Culp's Hill. Now, Culp's Hill, there's really more continuous fighting on Culp's Hill than any other place on the battlefield. On July 3rd, they're going to fight here for 7.5 hours. On July 2nd, the Union of July 2nd, they're going to fight for about 4 hours. So there's 11 to 12 hours of combat on this hill on July 2nd and July 3rd, the 2 days. And they're even going to have night fighting here.
Well, that was an introduction to John Cox in his guide role. John, do you remember that?
Oh, yeah, I remember that.
So I guess to begin this discussion, what inspired you to become a Gettysburg guide?
Well, my mom. I have to say, blame it on my mother. It's my mom. was a proud Virginian, one of the first families of Virginia. She instilled all these myths and legends of the great Southern heroes like Lee and Jackson and Jeb Stuart. And so, you know, I grew up in Connecticut with this Southern mom, all about the Civil War. When I was about 8 or 9 years old, I figured out that the Union won. You know, I figured out, when I was 10, I figured out that damn Yankees was two words. And so, you know, and if you're going to be involved in the Civil War, you want to be at Gettysburg, because that's the mecca of our American Civil War. So,
a question for you. Did you have that American Heritage big picture book? I had that too. And the two places on there that I had actually looked at the most frequently were Gettysburg and Franklin. And it was always those pictures. And my imagination would be running wild with them. How about yours?
Oh, absolutely. And in fact, my mom gave me that book, and I still own it to this day. You know, it's kind of tattered and everything. And I still go back and look at it. It had those great battle maps.
That's what stuff. I loved about it.
Yeah, I'd stare at them for hours on end. Yeah, absolutely.
So then, when was the first time you actually made a trip to Gettysburg?
I made a trip to Gettysburg. My dad, who was a Kentuckian, and his ancestors rode with John Morgan. And we grew up in Connecticut. So every year we would make a two-week trip by car from Connecticut to Kentucky. And during one of those trips, I guess I was 5 or 6 years old, my dad stopped at Gettysburg, and I got to go down at the angle there, Pickett's Charge. And, it was just an incredible thing to me to be at that place. And Gettysburg is an incredible place.
It is. Yeah, I've been there numerous times myself.
Mm-hmm.
First time I was there was actually in 98, and that was for the 135th anniversary reenactment. It was the largest Civil War reenactment event in the history of the hobby.
Right.
And they had a full-scale Pickett's Charge or the
Longstreet's
Assault, and we'll get into that in a little bit, but full-scale third-day charge. I was the chaplain of the 6th Wisconsin Medical at the time, and we were then attached to the 2nd Corps, just, as bodies, and I was actually one of the first people to attend to Winfield Scott Hancock when he was shot off his horse, and that reenactor actually fell off of his horse.
Well, that's not good.
No, but he said, after our sequence was over, he said that Hancock fell off of his horse, and I'm at Gettysburg, and by golly, I'm going to fall off my horse. And he did.
That's being authentic.
That was. But that was the first time I was there, and then I was stationed at Fort Meade, Maryland, numerous times in 99, 2003, and 2004. And I went up to Gettysburg every chance I got. And I probably ran into you a couple times, just didn't know you then.
Probably.
So then, what does it take to be a guide? Well, first, what made you decide to become a guide? I know it's a testing process and all involved.
Well, I went back later as an adult with my lovely wife, Barbara, and we hired a licensed battlefield guide, John Fuss, tremendous guide, the Iron Man of guiding, we call him. Of course, I didn't know that then. And 20 minutes into the tour, he said, what am I doing with this guy? Because I kept interrupting him and saying, let's go here or this or that. And halfway through the two-hour tour, I turned to Barb in the back seat and I said, I want to do this. And I started asking John Fuss, I just knew I wanted to do it. I asked him, how do you go about this? And not realizing, the amount of effort it takes to become that. And, he took me inside and introduced me to the late Clyde Bell, who gave me the information on how to take the testing process. And from that moment forward, the National Park Service just totally discouraged me in trying to do it. And so did some of the other guides. Well, when I told them I lived in Minnesota, they said, you'll never make it unless you're a local. You got to be local. And Gettysburg really is a small town, and the people who grow up around there, of course, have much more of an advantage, to just go to the be on the battlefield. So they started telling me 85% of the people that take the exam fail and how difficult it was, which, you know, if you know me, that only made me more determined. So I started studying up, read Coddington, you know, Edward Coddington's great book, A Study in Command, numerous times. Harry Fonts, I started going down to fit. I quit my job. I started living down in motels there, leaving Barb up here in Minnesota to work. It was more and more they discouraged me from taking the test, and I tried harder and harder, and it really is a difficult process. I have to say, for anybody who, you know, wants to do that, you got to really want to do it. Don't go and take the test just to see if you can pass or whatever. You got to go into it with the attitude that, you know, this is going to be my profession. This is what I'm going to do. Because it's a lengthy written test that lasts 4 hours.
4 hours.
Right. Multiple choice questions, true or false, matching, and then essay questions. And it covers the entire Civil War, not just Gettysburg. And when you pass that, if you pass that, you get ranked in order. And when a guide retires, which they really do, and, you know, I'm a unique case because I left guiding to come back to here and live in Minnesota. Most guides do it to the day they die. And it's also a great job if you're, you know, a retired. We have a lot of retired teachers, retired military.
What's the average age of a guide out there?
Oh, that's a, you know, I'd only have to, it's just an educated guess.
Yeah.
Probably about 50 to 60 years old, really.
So of those who take the test, how old is that demographic usually?
It's much older people seem to pass it. In fact, one of my good buddies down there, Tim Kraft, was for numerous years the youngest guide, and he was 30.
Wow.
So it's... Well, and you know, you also have to pass the written test. So you have to have some rapport with people, because you're going to be going around with, you know, families or one-on-one or groups of 50 or 100 of them. The Minnesota Governor's Task Force there, we had to get another guide. We had so many people.
Two buses
full, yeah. So
where did you score on the test?
I was in the... I think I was like in the top 10, ninth or something on the list, because you don't get the job until somebody retires or dies or something. So the test is always the second weekend in December.
Yeah.
And they'll come out with the results maybe in January or February. And then you have to take the oral exam, which a lot of people say is the hardest part of the test. I did mine in April, because I passed on April 9th, the day that Robert E. Lee and the Confederacy went down. And
made your mother proud.
In 1864, right. Yeah, she didn't want to remember that. So the oral test, you know, is really hard. So
the oral test, is that just giving a tour to a proctor?
Yeah, you have to give it... 2-hour tour, and you have to design the tour yourself, but you have to go, that was in your videotape, you have to do the battle in chronological order, first day, second day, third day. And you give the tour with a park historian and a licensed battlefield guide who dress up like civilians and try to their best to trip you up. I remember they give you two chances, and almost everyone fails the first chance. I remember within 20 minutes, they had me so messed up, I had the battle in Pittsburgh or something. It's just, they make it super difficult, and they should. The guys, it's a great tradition. And this is good for you to bring this up, because this is the 100th anniversary of the guides.
Wow, I did not know that.
Right, and they've been selling special pins, and the guys have a whole series of events at Gettysburg this year for their...
Interesting.
Although, if I can say, that's not really true, because the guides really started on July 4th.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, the day after the battle, as they civilians, you know, flocked to the battlefields, local guys, you know, would guide them to hospitals so that people could find their loved ones or their, you know, their loved ones who had died or were trying to recover. And that's kind of how the, you know, the guys really started. It was only in 1915 that the Park Service, the government finally had enough because the guides started learning that they could earn a couple of bucks, and they'd say any field on the battlefield was pickets charged, give me $5. And
then came standardization.
Regulations. The typical government interference and whatever.
Well, right now, we're going to go to another video clip of John giving a battlefield guide at Gettysburg. We are going to in just a minute here.
So Lutheran Theological Seminary, it's the oldest active Lutheran seminary in America.
Yeah.
We should
be a preacher.
All right. So I'll be quiet now. We're going to get off the bus and go to this great museum and go in the cupola. What a great day to do. You know, I thought I would never get a chance to get in this cupola, so that's really a good deal. And to see Jefferson Coates' Bible. All right.
It's awesome.
Worth it?
Oh, totally.
If these trees would have not been here, you would have had a better view if the railroad cut at the
Coons.
Yeah.
They had them as the Wisconsin infantry.
Yeah.
There's a thing in the to the far left.
Yeah. He was willing to show his wounds off. Yeah. He showed them to the school children, which is going to be part of our story later. They're on the skirmish line.
Lady is the oldest, just 13. Her parents work and live in the seminary.
The dying and dead are all around us.
Their wounds are like.
It was a ghastly sight to see so many men lying in pools of blood on the bare floor. Nurses and doctors were in demand every year.
Licensed battlefield guide at Gettysburg, and you were at the Seminary Ridge Museum, and that was your first time there?
Oh, well,
at the museum?
First time in the cupola.
Oh, first time in the cupola, okay.
For everybody, just yes. Right, because it was you just opened
day.
It, yeah.
So what did you think of the cupola?
Yeah, that's tremendous. For 10 years, I guided on the field and just, you know, looked up at it and, you know, never had the chance to go up there. What a fantastic thing that was, you know, where, you know, John Buford saw the Confederates coming in and, you know, on the first day and the battle started. And, you know, and I know, you know, Robert E. Lee, we only have him going up there once during the whole battle, even though it's a great panoramic view of, you know, Gettysburg and the field and stuff. Lee did not want to go in that building, which really was Schmucker Hall, right? Because, you know, it turned into a hospital. In fact, at least staff didn't want them going in there because of the, you know, Civil War hospitals aren't the greatest places to go into.
So now Jefferson Coates, you looked visibly moved when you were there. So tell us a little bit about him and what makes him so important.
Francis Jefferson Coates is a great, great American hero. You know, as I said, Francis Jefferson, yes. He didn't like the Francis. He dropped it, went to Jefferson. He was... Well, he was wounded badly in the chest with a spent ball at Antietam, but at Gettysburg he was shot through the face. He was in the 7th Wisconsin. The bullet entered in the right side, took out his right eye, exited out his left temple, took out his left eye. Was left propped up on a tree by his buddies who had to retreat, and was promptly stabbed in the chest by Confederates. Was taken to a hospital in Philadelphia, recuperated, went back to Wisconsin, got married, had a couple of kids, moved to Nebraska, told his wife, you know, I might be blind, and my vision's gone forever, but my mind is still good. I want you to read to me, you know, read everything you can to me. And his children always said that, you know, father was a deep thinker and had an active mind, and people said that Jefferson Coates could talk about any subject that you wanted to talk about and was virtually an expert. And he said to his wife, you know, he thought he had something to offer school children. So he started to tour the schools in Dorchester, Nebraska, there where he lived. And he'd let the kids touch his face and his wounds. And he'd always say the spent ball at him and hit him in the chest at Antietam was the wound that hurt him the worst.
Wow.
And he kept doing this, and they voted him actually like treasurer of the county schools and superintendent of schools, and a job he had to the day he died. So you know, it's a tremendous hero to overcome.
So how did you first hear about Jefferson Coates?
Well, I read a book on Medal of Honor winners by the U.S. Army, and I saw that there was an entry for Jefferson Coates because he was awarded the Medal of Honor.
His Medal of Honor citation, I pulled it up right here, for extraordinary heroism on 1 July 1863 while serving with Company H, 7th Wisconsin Infantry in action at Gettysburg, Pennsylvania, for unsurpassed courage in battle where he had both eyes shot out. That is his Medal of Honor citation.
There you
Not
go.
Like the ones today where it's like 5 pages long, but no, this one is like 2 or 3 sentences all strung together, just very short and sweet to the point. Matter of fact, there is something that I, Dallas, if you can come out here, I wanted to show you, because we're talking about July 1st, 1863, and of course, now that gets me excited because you know I'm the 14th Brooklyn guy.
Right.
And I guess first I wanted to show you something that I have in my possession.
There you go, yeah.
This is an original copy.
One of the originals.
Of the 1911 History of the Fighting 14th.
Right.
If you open it up, here, we'll get presented
wow.
to Honorary Commander Wendy Berry by the Fighting 14th Infantry Post 546 of the Veterans of Foreign Wars of the United States. Now, this book is the regimental history book of the 14th Brooklyn New York State Militia. Wendy Berry was a famous actress in the 1930s. She was the goddaughter of J.M. Berry, who wrote Peter Pan.
Okay.
Now, the name Wendy originated from Peter Pan, and she adopted the name Wendy as her stage name, and so that book was presented in the 1930s to Wendy Berry.
Wow.
The very first Wendy.
Tremendous. Yeah, that's great. I have a reprint copy myself because I couldn't afford anything like this. Here you go.
So let me, if we can go to camera one, Dallas.
The 14th Brooklyn, charged with Rufus Dawes.
Yes.
Railroad Dawes.
So here is a 1911 copy of the History of the Fighting 14th. And then here is the... Now, I have not had a chance to look and see if any of these names matched up on any of the rosters or anything like that. But these were the members of the VFW post at that point in time. Now, I want to show you another 14th Brooklyn item that I have. And it's quite a large one.
No, all right. Tremendous. With the Zouaves and the letter. What is that, Jeff?
So this, we'll try to, with only having one cameraman and a producer being the same person, sometimes a little difficult. But here we have a letter from September 11th, 1863, by Company K, the W.F. Tourbel, the captain. And he writes on September 11th, 1863, from Rappahannock Station, Virginia, "Sir, I have to report the following list of arms as lost in action by the members of my company July 1st, 1863. In the hands of killed and left on the field, 1. In the hands of wounded and left on the field, 3. In the hands of those captured by the enemy, 5. For a total of 9, none captured by the enemy. W.F. Tourbel, Captain, 14th Regiment, New York State Militia, commanding K Company."
Well, that's, you know, the stories of the muskets left on the field after Gettysburg?
For our viewers, Enlighten us.
Over 28,000 rifled muskets, because both sides mostly carry rifled muskets. Not too many smoothbores, some. More with the Union with smoothbores. But over 28,000 rifles were found after the battle by the U.S. Army, 24,000 of which were loaded.
Wow.
12,000 of which, 6,000 of which were loaded more than three to 12 times.
I had heard that.
Yeah, right. Well, because, you know, the Union Army, and, you know, I think a lot of it still goes on today, they spent a lot of money training. Well, they didn't want to spend a lot of money to train the men. And so, you know, as a reenactor, you know that to load a rifle musket is 9 counts.
Yep.
But they wouldn't give the 9th order, which was to fire, because they wanted to save the bullets. So a lot of the men just kept reloading in the heat of combat. They never fired. So over 6,000 of the 28,000 that they found were loaded 3 to 12 times.
Wow. Well, actually, we have one more thing to show real briefly here. You've got two other books.
I highlighted one,
but let's take a quick look. You've got your
this
first
is my,
book.
Culp's Hill book, which
Culp's Hill.
Published in 2003.
Tell me about Culp's Hill, because that seemed to be an area where you specialize.
Culp's Hill, again, you know, I like the more obscure places at Gettysburg, if there is anything obscure about Gettysburg. But people know probably less about Culp's Hill than any other part of the battlefield. I think on the evening of July 2nd, it was Lee's best chance to win. He had about 4,000 men attack 1,000 men of the Union Army up on Culp's Hill. And George Sears Green from Rhode Island had done some combat engineering, best combat engineering, if you're into that kind of thing, at the Battle of Gettysburg's Culp's Hill, where he built trenches and fortifications and outnumbered over 4 to 1. The right flank of the Army of the Potomac at Gettysburg was held because of Green and his leadership and his combat engineering.
Who is the guy from Kansas in San Francisco?
Oh, that's John White Gary.
Yes.
Which, here's something for your viewers. You know, there's a guy who needs a biography. There's a guy, first mayor of San Francisco, first governor or military governor of Kansas, huge guy, over 6'8". Gary Boulevard in San Francisco is named after him. Most San Franciscans that I have met do not realize that. A great statue of General Gary there at Gettysburg on Culp's Hill, although kind of when Green was being attacked, Gary kind of got lost in the darkness and actually marched off the field. Maybe I shouldn't say that for the Gary residents, but, you know, ancestors, but there's a guy who needs a biography, John White Gary.
Okay, well, what we're going to do is we're going to show one more clip, and this is going to be of what everybody knows as Pickett's Charge. Now, there's, of course, a couple of different names. I know Longstreet's Assault was one of them, but this is John Cox telling us on the 150th anniversary of what was going on.
Pickett, Pettigrew, and Trumbull Assault, all right? And that's 9 brigades. They're going to come like, there are 2 big blocks in a line. And we're that little U-shape in the woods there. By the way, see the monument over there? That's the Lee Monument. We all saw Lee. And look at, there in back of you is General Meade. So we have Meade and Lee looking at each other. And you notice that the Meade statue is a little higher than Lee. Because Meade wins, so you get to be higher. All right? Now, so our left, the patch of woods on the left, Pickett's men will be there. How many people saw the Gettysburg movie? Remember they have the artillery shelling and all the Pickett's men are in the woods? Not true. Only one regiment's in the woods. They're really in front of the woods. But there's a big dip in the ground there. You wouldn't even see them. Big dip in the ground. All right, then there's the space where Lee is. It's called, the point of the woods, that point where the trees are right there where Pickett's men. The Lee watches most of Pickett's charge from that spot right there. Now, the woods to the left and back of those woods would be Pettigrew and Trumbull's division. All they have to do is come straight ahead because Lee wants to attack this angle right here. See how the stone wall zigzags like a Z? It's a salient position, very hard to defend. It looks really awkward. That's why we have the line of monuments down there the Union Army, then this big space, and then the line of monuments here. Because if you were on my tour, I would have told you, if you see a line of monuments, it's a Union battle.
And if we can actually pull up my computer, I have the Pickett's Charge map from the Civil War Trust. And if there's anything you want to explain, tell us about the charge. That's, I think, what most people want to know.
Well, what you need to know is this is desperate times or desperate measures. And this is Robert E. Lee. And maybe in Lee's mind, this is his last chance to really win the war. He's got the Yankees on their home turf. He's beat them up for 2 days. And, you know, he wants to smash through this line. It's still said to be the loudest noise ever heard on the North American continent, the artillery bombardment, that is, before the attack. Largest artillery bombardment for the war is about 150 or more Confederate guns are going to center on the angle, the stone wall that forms.
So the copse of trees is kind of right here. I don't know if you can see this. I'm kind of moving the cursor down. It's, you know...
Right. And right today, right the copse of trees is much larger than it was even then.
Well, I've actually had some questions about that that I wanted to actually ask you today.
Sure.
Because there's been a recent discussion on the American Civil War Facebook group. And by the way, I happen to be the Civil War black market guy.
That's right.
You know, every now and then I'm in this group with almost 11,000 other Civil War.
I spent a lot of time on that.
And so I brought John in, and he wanted to invite people in, but he was having difficulty. So every now and then he'll shoot me an email. Hey, this person wants to join.
So honestly, Jeff, it was a mistake because so many people email me to get in that group. I spent so much time. I said, I feel like I'm a black marketeer sending you these people.
Yeah, and I have no problem with that. So, you know, I'm the Civil War black market guy for the American Civil War Facebook group. Keep increasing the membership. But one of the more recent discussions that came up just the other day, as a matter of fact, you know, you had already agreed to come on the show, and then this thing pops up, about the size of the copse of trees, even in 1882, was small.
Mm-hmm.
And so people on that discussion, on that thread, were wondering if the copse of trees really was the intended target, not Ziegler's Grove, which would have been much larger and easier to see.
Right.
Have there been any writings or anything that you've researched that would uncover, like, a written thing from Lee saying we were going for the copse of trees? Or where did this copse of trees thing come from?
Well, it's the copse of trees, and I do write a lot about that in the Gettysburg book. And I'd be remiss if I didn't mention Troy Harmon, one of the historians at Gettysburg, you know, wrote a whole book on what you're talking about, the copse of trees being the target of the attack. And actually, you know, Hayes's guys in the 2nd Division, Alexander Hayes, who's just north of where the 1st Minnesota is in the charge, Hayes's men thought they were the target of the attack at Ziegler's Grove. They were in front of Ziegler's Grove. Well, but the thing, I think the angle is the point of the attack. Because it is an angle and a salient position that can be flanked, you know, hit in front and hit on the sides, you know, it's the angle this way. It was a hard position for the Union Army to defend. The Confederate,
would Lee have been able to see that from that distance?
Oh, absolutely, and that's where the copse of trees comes in.
Okay.
Because Lee is using that as a visible point of attack. You know, the artillery, which, you know, Civil War artillery used direct fire. They only shot at things they could see. The copse of trees, because the ridge there was bare. And if you go to Gettysburg and walk around, you can, you know, it's all these stones and rough ground. And there's this little patch of trees right where this angle is, right in back. So it gives the artillery a fixed position to fire at. And it also gives the men who are going 7/8 of a mile over open terrain a point. Because Lee knows it's going to be confusion going across that field. They're going to get hit with... It's incredible to even think about it.
What were the field conditions that day?
It was about 89 degrees and about 100% humidity.
Wow.
So, and you know, a lot of these fellas for the Confederacy and the Union have fought on previous days. Mm-hmm. So, you know, they need some time to recover and what have you. And then there's even Lee, when he inspected some of the men, before the attack said, you know, these guys need to be in the hospital. And then he shook his fist and said, this attack must succeed. So, you know, there's been a lot of debate about that. I wrote a lot about that in the book. And, you know, I always liked Troy Harmon. We had discussions about it. I think if you take away the copse of trees, then you take away the angle. And the angle seems like, and Lee was correct, at that moment, the weakest part of the Union line at Gettysburg. So I think, you know, and the other reason why I think the attack happens there, because that's where the guys march to an attack. Yep. You know, and the Confederate soldiers, even though there's no written documentation, there were a few fellows, I think A.P. Alexander wrote that every man, you know, was briefed on where to go. So even though, you know, we don't know, they knew, you know. So, you know, that to me has got to be the attack.
Well, we're starting to run low on time. We're going to have to get you back. Yeah,
we could do a couple of hours here.
But we absolutely could. But give us a quick guide story.
A quick guide story?
Something that comes to mind of something that happened while you were guiding.
Well, I could do a million. Here's a sad one, which shouldn't happen. You know, guide tours were 2 hours. To get to the Minnesota Monument, where they charge, if you're a guide and you're doing it in chronological order, as you should be, unless it's a crowded battlefield and you can't, you get to the Minnesota Monument later on in the tour. So I had this Minnesota family. You know, I parked near the Minnesota Monument to go talk to the charge, and the mom gets out of the car and she says, "Really? Minnesota was in the Civil War?" See, so I think that's got to be your job and my job to tell people, yeah, Minnesota was in the Civil War, and if the first Minnesota guys don't make that charge, you know, we're not living the way we're living today.
That's right.
You know, and that's how important that was. And, you know, people from Minnesota, you know, you should know that about, you know, the heritage of where you come from and what have you. But
so now I understand you have a new book. So this will be your third book.
Yeah, my third book.
And that right here.
Well, and I broke the mold with this one.
You sure did. Comparing the covers of these three.
Yeah, I get you know what people
had a really good cover and then a generic cover. Now this is really
basic.
Yes. Well, so if we can go to camera one here, and this is John's. Oh, we're going to do in camera three. Okay.
The guides. I like simple covers. Novel. Elegant and simple. But people complain that my covers are. You know, too basic.
So, The Guide's a novel is a fun-filled, zany comedy with adult themes that follow a group of Washington, D.C. tour guides into a world of international espionage.
Well,
where did you come up with that?
Well, why I'm here, you know, I guided at Gettysburg for 10 years, and I got to say it carefully, you know, I stored up things. And while I was writing the Gettysburg book here, which took me about 4.5 years of physical writing.
And where can you get any of these books?
Just go to Amazon. Have them at the Minnesota History
Center.
Yeah, and you know if you're in Gettysburg, you can pick it up anywhere. But Amazon. So you know, I stored up a whole bunch of stories, and I wanted this was a really hard book to write, and I wanted to write something light and funny, and. You know, just for, you know, entertainment. And so it's only been out a week. So my first try at some fiction and, you know, there you have it.
Well, we're going to take a quick look right now because we are starting to run low on time of a video of Abraham Lincoln's Gettysburg Address. And I want your comments after the video.
Sure.
Years ago, our father brought forth upon this continent a new nation, conceived in liberty and dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal. Now, we're engaged in a great civil war, testing whether that nation, or any nation so conceived and so dedicated, can long endure. We are met on a great battlefield of that war. We have come to dedicate a portion of that field as the final resting place for those who here gave their lives that that nation might live. It is altogether fitting and proper that we should do this. But in the larger sense, we cannot dedicate, we cannot consecrate, we cannot hallow this ground. The brave men, living and dead, who struggled here have consecrated it far above our poor power to add or detract. The world will little note nor long remember what we say here, but it can never forget what they did here. It is for us, the living, rather, to be here dedicated to the unfinished work which they who fought here have thus far so nobly advanced. It is for us to be here dedicated to the great task remaining before us, that from these honored dead, we take increased devotion to that cause for which they here gave the last full measure of devotion, and that we here highly resolve that these dead shall not have died in vain, that this nation under God shall have a new birth of freedom, and that government of the people, by the people, for the people, shall not perish from the earth.
Well, that was Max Daniels, who was the ex officio vice president of the Association of Lincoln Presenters, who was given the narration with some video of the monuments at Gettysburg. John Cox, our licensed battlefield guide from Gettysburg, what is your thoughts of that?
I loved how you did it with the monuments and whatnot. You know, this Gettysburg is, you know, filled with those monuments, and I like how you had the delegation that went there putting the flags, and I remember it, you know, it was so hot and everything, and then it was raining.
It was raining.
Right when we were leaving, and you had the Minnesota urn there, you know, the first one of the first monuments put on the battlefield there in the National Cemetery, and you have, you know, Lincoln's speech, which, you know, you talk about writing. I don't think there's a greater speech ever been written by
certainly not Edward Everett's.
No, not, or Pericles for that matter. Yeah. There's words by Lincoln, to bring the country together through the worst crisis we've seen. You know, we have a presidential election coming, and the country has problems, but, you know, nothing like we saw then. And I think Lincoln really summed up this awful war with those words. And that's a good presentation.
Well, thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome, Jeff.
Well, I got one last thing for you, and I'm just something that after doing this for 10 years, in the last couple of seconds we got left, 15 seconds or less, do you ever get tired of Gettysburg?
Because I can't get away from it. I left, I haven't been there. I stopped guiding in, 2009? And, I did 2 Gettysburg talks last year. And now, you know, sometimes I think I am, and then I sit down and I read something and it spurs my interest again. I just found out some stuff on General Hancock, that his brother Hillary, his twin brother, practiced law in Minneapolis.
Wow.
How about that?
And we're going to leave it at that. John Cox, our guest today.
Thanks,
thank you. And I'm Jeff Williams. We'll see you next week on North Star Oasis.